Waiting. What up?
What's up, dude?
How's it going?
Good. How are you doing?
Hold on, I gotta play my theme song. That's how to start every show.
Okay.
Are you ready? That's it.
Did you make that in Pro Tools?
Ableton.
You switched?
Yeah, man.
When?
Like five years ago. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I just remember you being one of the only people I remember in Pro Tools still.
Yeah. It was it's because when I first started, Mastercraft were kind of like my mentor dudes, and he was like, just use Pro Tools because he's a band guy.
I mean, Pro Tools is amazing for a lot of things. Still.
It's still the best for comping a vocal, I think.
Yeah, I agree, for sure.
What do you use?
For comping Pro Tools, but Cubase for the rest.
So you're still on Cubase?
Since 2004.
Would you ever switch?
I'm not sure if I would.
Yeah.
I don't know is it 2004 or 14? I don't even know. It doesn't matter. I don't think I would switch because I just know it so well at this point.
Yeah.
It's all the same. You can use whatever you want. You can get the same result out of it. It's just whatever. It's like coding language, whatever coding language you know best.
Totally.
It's problem solving.
It's kind of like it's like picking a brand of a guitar. You know, you just have to pick one. They're all going to make the same sounds, kind of, I think, at the end of the day.
Yeah. Or like speakers. Like, some people think that one brand of speakers is so much better than the other. Ultimately, you can produce music on any set of speakers as long as you know what the information that comes out of it means.
Yeah. No. Well, I remember when I started, I was on Reason, and I would always hate on it so much because I was like, I can't make anything sound good. And then, like,
Reason?
A record would come out, and that would sound, and then someone would tell me that it was made on Reason. I was like, so it is possible.
Reason was hard because for the longest time, Reason didn't have audio, it was all MIDI.
Yeah, so
you remember Lucky Date was in Reason, and he made crazy sounding music, and he was like the only one that I can think of. And back in band times, I remember in MySpace times, there used to be a band called Sky It's Airplane that I love, and they had a lot of electronics, and I messaged them on MySpace, and I was like, "What you guys use?" And like, we use Reason, so I got Reason. I did not understand a single thing in it.
Well, Reason to me is basically just a VST, basically. It's not even really a full-on DAW.
Well, some people, I guess, use it to link into their other DAW, but it became a DAW, right, over time?
Yeah, now you can use audio on it, but I just find it, I don't know, I just needed to reset, you know?
Whatever works. Lucky Date crushed it with it.
Whatever works.
What's up with
how's
you?
How's your quarantine been going?
Yeah, it's been going good for me. If I don't play shows, I'm basically living the exact same lifestyle I live in quarantine.
Yeah.
I don't leave my house. I'm in the studio, which, you know, which is basically just a bedroom at the moment.
Yeah.
I'm making music, and then I play video games at night, and I work out, and I do all that from home. So for me, not much has changed, to be completely honest. The one thing that is really nice for me to see it positively is that while all the shows are canceled, and that's obviously a real bummer, it's for the, like, I've never had a real, real break. Because even if I don't play festivals or even if I don't go on a tour, I still have Vegas, which is constant.
Right.
I've never had a break like this since I started my career. So it's kind of nice to be able to sit down and just think. I feel like everybody's really, right now, trying really hard to do everything they can at once. While maybe it's not a bad time to just sit back and think a little bit and just reflect.
No, I think that's like a really good point. I think it's like, I think when you, I'm like a big fan of restrictions. So it's kind of weird. Like this restriction has been put on everyone. And I think sometimes that's like, gives you a way to think about things differently.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Like, for example, when Vine came out, I loved Vine because it was like, it's 6 seconds and that's it. And I just like, that's how, like, all this cool videos came out because there's, like, this really harsh restriction being put on it. So, like, I don't know. Maybe that's, like, the silver lining of the coronavirus. I don't know.
I mean, we'll get through it without a doubt. And I think that it's nice that there's strict rules in place right now.
Yeah.
As much as it's not fun.
Yeah.
But it's good and it saves lives. And I think everybody should be.
Do you feel like it's affected your creativity, like at all, like what you're thinking about when you're writing, or is it just the same for you?
Well, when this quarantine started, I sort of quarantined myself like a week before anyway, just because I had to finish some music. So, and when I do that, I'm pretty much just locked in anyway.
Yeah.
And I finish two songs a lot quicker than I normally do, maybe because there's less distraction. I mean, especially at home, there's just always a lot of friends at my house and creatives and people walking around. And I kind of, because I'm in the process of making an album as well, I set the rule for myself to try to be more alone so I can focus more on work. Mm-hmm. And that actually ironically started before the quarantine, before the coronavirus even knowingly was a thing here in America.
Yeah.
And I feel like I was a lot more creative. And then when we got forced to have like a full shutdown, I also kind of want to take a little bit of time and just take time off and do other things. The most normal thing people do is watch Netflix all day.
Yeah.
I have never watched Netflix all day. Just like sit down and just watch it all day, because I feel guilty when I don't work. It's a weird thing.
I'm the same way.
Because I shouldn't feel ever guilty for taking a day off, but I do. Even if I don't do anything for 24 hours, I like inside of me, it's like, I should be doing something.
Yeah, no, I agree. I actually like started writing my days off in my schedule and then just like planning to fully have a day off. So that way I remove like the thing in the back of my head that's like, you should be doing something today. I'm just like, no, this is the write off. I get all my stuff done leading up to that day. And it's like once every, I don't know, 12 days or something.
What's your schedule like at the moment? Like, what's your daily schedule like? I mean,
like currently or just in general?
Right now, what in the next 4 weeks?
I mean, I'm still pretty productive musically. So I still try to write for like 4 hours a day if I can, like just work on stuff. And now I'm doing this talk show. So I like prep for these interviews for like half an hour every day.
Wow.
It was nice. And then I've still been going out for runs, just trying to find places where not people. So
where do you live?
In Vancouver, in Canada.
In Vancouver. I love Vancouver, man.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
I really love Vancouver.
But it's such like so sushi. Beautifully like natureful that like there's a lot of people out still, which is kind of uncomfortable.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. So if you go
LA on, like, is dead.
Yeah. I mean, it's dead in the city, but if you go on the seawall, it's almost like busier. It's kind of weird.
Really? Well, I can see that because right before we were forced to stay home, I went on a hike. Mm-hmm. And I was going to go on a hike that's really close to my house, which is not even 10 minutes away. And there were cars parked all on the road towards that hike. And I was like, wait, this is crazy. I thought we're in the process of all staying home. But then I thought, well, I'm the one who's thinking everybody's staying home, so I'm going to go. Yeah. And everybody else probably thinks that too. So I think everybody was getting their hikes out of the way last day possible. But there's always places you can go where nobody is if you need to get out, which totally. Is understandable.
Yeah. I saw this meme that was like before the quarantine, everybody on their phones. And then like during the quarantine, everyone's like outside enjoying. It's like so accurate.
It's ironic. It's very ironic. You always want what you don't have in life.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have some questions.
Hit me.
You grew up in Germany, right?
Yep.
I'm going to try and pronounce the city you grew up in. I read it on your Wikipedia. Kaiserslautern.
That's really good. Kaiserslautern. Right? Yeah, really good.
So what was Kaiserslautern like? Is it, how big is the city?
We have, if you count all the little villages around it,
mm-hmm.
you can maybe with some finessing get to 100,000 people.
Okay.
So that's not very big.
Yeah.
It's small. If you fart on one side of the island, you hear it on the other side of the island.
It's an island?
No. But you know what I mean. It's like the land. You can't escape anywhere, anything. Everything you do, everybody knows. It's very small. There wasn't only one club, one proper big club to go to.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when we went out, was before DJs were a thing. So you just went on a specific day, not because you want to see somebody play.
Mm-hmm.
But I, instead of having, you know, a lot of options, you were forced to hang out with people and make connections. And
the worst.
Weird, right? I still have the same friends from back in the day. I've known them for 20 years. They still come visit me 4 times a year. And we see each other every time possible. So I, you know, while the city didn't have a lot to offer, it offered me the best friends possible.
Have you gone back and played at that one club in Kaiserslautern?
I have not, but I actually genuinely wanted to play a show there. And it's actually hard. It's like people, you know, people write us always, come to XYZ, like play a show here. Why don't you do that? Yeah. It's not that easy. It's not like you just show up and everybody's rolling you the red carpet and making things happen. Like, I really wanted to play a show in my hometown for a while. Yeah. And there's a little hall, which is like 800 people, which is too small. And then there's a 45,000 person stadium, which is too big. And that's about it.
You need that. There's not a whole lot of somewhere in the middle, maybe.
I would like something in the middle. No pun intended, but I'm still working on it. I still want to do it. I feel like, I mean, for you, it's easy. You probably played a million times in Vancouver, right?
Yeah, but I actually grew up in a suburb as well, and I've never played in the suburb that I grew up in. So I think
that's the suburb.
It's called New Westminster, which is about it's like a 30-minute drive from Vancouver, so it's still close. But I've never gone back and done like a show in the like proper, because I only like the city that I grew up in had one high school is tiny.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. But you played celebrities.
I do. Yeah, I played celebrities lots. And the festivals. And I mean, Vancouver's a major city, so it's not as like, I think
major
city. The weird thing would be going back to like playing a really, really small town and just like trying to like throw a rave or something.
Okay. Yeah. Which isn't impossible.
Not impossible. I think the people of Kaiserslautern want it, is all I'm saying. I'm putting it.
I hope for their support if I come back.
They're like, look, Anton, you couldn't get into the club when you were 19. You're not going to get in now.
You can. Germany, 18 is the magic number.
Oh, it's 18?
18. Well, you guys are 19, right? In Canada?
19, most of Canada, except for two provinces, are 18.
Oh, okay.
Quebec and Alberta.
Okay.
So
For us, 18 for everything.
Yeah, so Montreal, when you go, is 18.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice. Nice.
Nice. I read that Justice was like the first group to influence you into music, or electronic music.
Yeah. Yes. I heard Daft Punk was probably the first one to catch my attention. I really was obsessed with Daft Punk, with Discovery specifically. Mm-hmm. In a time when I only listened to rock. Really?
Yeah.
And then I think when I heard Justice, it gave me that same French electronic vibe, but produced on a whole nother level, which in no disrespect to Daft Punk, but I still think, I don't know when Cross came out. It must have been a long time.
2007, I think.
It came out 2007. Okay. So,
Yeah.
It still to this day is one of the best sounding records and sounds better than the majority of music coming out today, in my opinion. And I still don't even know what it is. I don't know if it's the mastering, because the compression is obnoxious and there's like a bit crusher on almost everything. I don't know how it's made, but it's still to this day one of the fattest sounding things. And you hear their snares sampled all over the place.
Totally. Well, I feel like they're like one of the first electronic acts where like their beats are like way more on the 2 and 4 than a straight 4/4.
True.
And that was like the biggest thing for me. So it was like, because it's slow. Most of their songs are slow.
Yeah.
You know? Ish.
Yeah.
Like slow first.
It's just a lot more musical.
Yeah.
I feel like song first.
Do you remember the first song you heard by Justice?
I heard the Cross album from start to finish.
Oh, wow. That's great.
On a grocery run. I grabbed, somebody's like, you got to listen to that album. I literally didn't even know what it is.
Yeah.
Back when CDs were a thing and your car had that little thing, you put the CD in, amazing times. And I put that album and I was like, wow, this is fucking amazing. This is really good.
For me, it was like one of those feelings where like when I first heard like the punk music that I grew up on, I got like a really weird feeling of like, what even is this? And then when I heard that style of electronic music, I got that same feeling, but I didn't think I would get that same feeling again in my life. So it was like really exciting. I was like, what is even happening?
Yeah, it's new, it's different.
Yeah,
it's the one thing about music that is so fascinating is that music isn't just the music itself, it's when you hear it, where you hear it, what happens socially. That's what music really is.
True.
Like a lot of people say, make another Clarity or whatever. Yeah. If I made another Clarity today, it would not be the same as it was when it came out at the festivals, when this kind of music was new, when vocals and EDM was kind of cheesy, partially.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just not the same. You have to progress and keep moving forward. And I think Justice, when that happened, was just so new on every level and just felt so weird and amazing.
Yeah. Well, if people want to hear Clarity, they can just listen to it. It's already been made.
You can listen to it anywhere you want.
All right, I have a question. Do you have any idea what your first upload to YouTube is?
I have no clue. Do you?
Yeah, I looked it up.
What is it?
Can you guess?
I have no clue at all. Like my first song?
It is a song, yeah.
Is it The Witch Doctor?
No, it's not. It's a remix, actually.
Love Key.
Sorry?
Love Key?
No.
I didn't even know when I started my YouTube.
I'll give you, it's a 2010 upload, if that helps.
Okay. Doesn't help.
All right, I'm going to
show you. The Anthem? Oh, that is my first upload, really?
That's your first upload, yeah.
Kind of fire, to be honest.
I don't think I had heard it, but I listened to it, and it's pretty banger, bro.
It's pretty good. Wow, first upload, huh?
But I don't think it has your, like, I don't think your signature had really come on it yet.
A couple of the sounds I used for a long time, especially in the last drop.
Yeah.
That, like, electronic guitar-ish bass. That's something
I can hear, like, you defining the things that are working for you. It's cool.
It's actually really ironic because I'm right now working on writing a song for a movie. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking of trying something with that exact sound.
Really?
In the second half, there's, like, this distorted organ-ish sound that sounds like an electric guitar or bass.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I'm going to try something with that sound today. 10 years later.
And you were thinking of that remix when you had
this sound. I wasn't thinking of the remix, okay. But now that you played it or showed it, I was like, wait, that remix has that sound in it.
That's funny. Well, now you got to listen to it again. Maybe there's five other good sounds in there that you can
do. I might.
Okay. I have a question. I want to see if you can finish these lyrics. Okay.
I suck with lyrics. You know this.
I know, but I'll give you a hint. It's a band that you love.
Okay.
Well, I tripped, I fell down naked. Well, I scratched my knees, they bled. Sew up my eyes, need no more. In our game, there is no score. Forgive me, Father, why should you bother?
Can you sing it?
Forgive me, Father, why should you bother?
Okay, that helps me more, but I need to hear the whole thing. Please, one more time. One semitone up.
I can't sing, man. This is brutal.
You can.
Forgive me, Father, why should you bother? And that's the
name. Okay, I just got you to sing in front of everybody. I'm kind of proud for this.
Yeah, I don't care.
I can't finish it. It's a band I really like. Is it in the emo world?
No, it's kind of emo, but it's rock. It's like, they're pretty heavy. And they're Canadian, a Canadian rock band.
Is it Billy Talent?
It is.
It is. What's the song?
Try Honesty.
Okay. Which album is it on?
I don't remember, but it was like their big hit in Canada, but maybe there was a different big hit in Germany by them or something.
The big hit in Germany I heard first was the one that starts with the guitar, that it's like a guitar riff intro. Do you know which song I mean?
I feel like all of their songs are guitar riff intros.
Fair enough.
Oh, wait, so why so do you good. Like, why do you love Billy Talent though? Because they're a Canadian band, so I'm Canadian, thought we'd, you know.
I want to say that they're most known in Germany and Canada.
Yeah.
And here we are. I just thought they were awesome. I don't know. I heard them
at a
long time ago.
Concert in the pit.
Do they still make music?
I don't know, actually. I haven't really like looked into what they've been up to.
It's been a long, long time. I don't even know how old that is, but I heard it on MTV. I woke up, turned MTV on, my TV, saw that song or the video, never heard of it before, absolutely loved it. It's really good.
They got it like their own sound. Like they really sound like no one else. So
yeah. And they're known in Canada.
I always appreciate that. Yeah. They were massive in Canada. For
really?
Sure.
Awesome.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Canada has such a good music scene. You guys are very lucky.
Well, Canada appreciates that. okay. So on my show, I don't do the top five. I do the bottom five. So we're going to find your five least favorite things right now.
Least favorite things?
Yeah, I'm going to ask you five questions, and you have to give me your least favorite, not your top favorite.
Okay.
Because it's boring. I don't care what people's favorite things are. I want to know what their least favorite things are.
Okay, cool.
So, is there a food that you cannot eat?
Blue cheese is the devil.
You just hate it?
absolutely hate it. There's nothing worse. Okay, there's things that most people like. Most people like, if you eat meat, most people like chicken. Like, I don't know, people are like, chicken, oh, that's weird. Most people like apples.
Yeah.
But when you ask about blue cheese, the answer is either it's the devil, or it's like, I'm okay with it. So why even bother? If it's between hating and barely okay with it, then there's some psychopaths who love it, who think it's the greatest thing on earth.
I really like it.
Okay. It was nice talking to you. Okay. Well, blue cheese is my answer.
That's fair. You said it very quickly, so I know there's a strong hate there, which I
appreciate. Absolutely. I'm a hater.
Do you have a least favorite clothing trend right now?
What's trendy right now?
Or just a least favorite clothing trend in general. It doesn't have to be current. Do you see someone wearing something and just like, why? Why would you do that?
So I'll name one on the guy side and one on the girl side. I have never understood guys who wear like super boxy shirts that are wider than they're long. So you can always see your belly button.
Yeah. I hate
but that. You can fit 8.5 families in your shirt. I never got that. It just doesn't complement the aesthetic of a human body, in my opinion.
I agree.
On the female side, I've never been a fan of pants going all the way up. I don't know like the
high-waisted jeans.
Is that what it is? You know what I mean, right?
Yeah, you mean like jeans that come up higher, right?
The opposite would be Christina Aguilera in what's the song?
Dirty.
Dirty. That's the exact opposite of that. That's like low.
Yeah.
Somewhere in between is the norm.
Yeah.
And then there's a trend where it's like up to your chin.
Kind of like the mom jean, I think is what they call it a little bit.
So, okay. Well, yeah. I'm not a fashion expert, I'll admit. But that's not my thing. That's not my jam. I don't hate it. It's just not my thing.
That's fair. I think I'll take the higher jean rather than the really, really low jean, though, I think.
I don't mind the low jean.
Well, I mean, really that's low jean is... Christina Aguilera Dirty video. Let's be
real. Yeah, I do. Of course I love that. Everybody loves that. Come on.
The age that I was when that came out, I really loved it. Let's be real.
I loved it. I still love it to this day.
Do you have a least favorite song?
I do, but if I say it, then people are going to cancel me, you know?
That's why I want you to say it.
I think everybody knows my least favorite song.
Really? I don't.
Absolutely. I got canceled 8.5 times for expressing that I don't like a song, so I'm just going to pass on answering that question because in 2020, and maybe you don't know this,
yeah.
But in 2020, if you make music, you're not allowed anything other than making music. Every other right is taken away from you. So you're not allowed to have opinions. You're not allowed to express not liking a song. So therefore, I'm going to not say what song I don't like. But it's a song that I just don't find incredibly lyrically pleasing or musically enjoyable.
All right. Well, this is the most controversial show on TV then because you've expressed many opinions tonight. And
true.
I am triggered, by the way.
It probably is my last interview ever, too.
All right, I'm texting you after to ask you what the song was.
Of course, I'll tell you.
Okay, do you have a least favorite alcohol and a corresponding story to go with why this alcohol can no longer be consumed?
Let's think about this. I want to answer this correctly. Are we talking like hard liquors or?
Could be any alcohol, but for a lot of people, it is a hard liquor, I find.
Okay. I love whiskey. I drink a lot of tequila. I don't often drink vodka, but I do like vodka.
Yeah.
I guess I could sum it up with I like alcohol. If I had to pick something, my least favorite, probably beer, because I need to drink so much of it.
Oh, yeah.
To get to the same level as one beverage that to me tastes better could get me to. It makes me bloated. And I shouldn't be drinking beer, as I found out. I did a food sensitivity test a few months ago, and I found out that something that's in beer, I shouldn't be having. So,
Are you allergic to it?
Not allergic, but I have a high sensitivity to it.
Oh, gotcha. Well, I was touring with Linus from Galantis Style of Eye, like way back in the day, and he was like, he told me a story of. I just asked him if he's having drinks tonight. He's like, no, I actually, after drinking for like 10 years, I used to get the worst hangovers. And then I went to a doctor and they're like, how have you ever drank? You're the most allergic to alcohol I've ever met. Someone, whoa, they drank for like 10 years and just thought like the crazy hangovers you would get after one drink were just what everybody else was experiencing.
I mean, I used to not get hungover, but you feel it when you get a little older. You feel it.
Oh yeah.
You feel it a lot. I guess I had some unpleasant experiences with Bailey's.
Oh yeah.
But Bailey's tastes so good. It's so delicious. No disrespect, Bailey's. You got an amazing product going. I just have had a little too much of it. Ouzo's up there with cringe-worthy moments.
Yeah.
Sambuca and Ouzo.
Sambuca is rough for me. That's like, anyways. All right, so do you have a least favorite interview question?
Probably, what's your most hated song at the moment? I've had so many unpleasant questions asked in my life that I just surf around them.
You're like a politician. You just dodge that question. And
I dodge the question or like a soccer player. Like, why'd you guys lose? I think it's important to focus on the next game. Okay. I just learned to sort of ignore the stuff you don't want to answer, because I've been in situations on live interviews, like on live TV, where before we went live, we're like, hey, you can ask anything you want. Just, if you don't mind, just please don't ask this question. They're like, of course, don't worry about it. Live in 3, 2, 1. And they ask you that question 5 seconds later. Like, so they just don't have a soul.
Just so how right now you avoided answering my question, what's your least favorite interview question? Smart.
See? Very not smart. Bad.
Not bad. Not bad. That was good.
You almost got some experience in it.
All right. You want to hear some jokes?
Hit me.
We got some Corona jokes because
okay,
this show is a real talk show, and this is the joke portion.
Hit me.
Someone looked at me at the store today and angrily yelled, 6 feet. I said 6'2", but good guess.
Doesn't work well with me because I'm a midget, but okay.
Yeah, I'm not 6'2 either. But
how tall are you?
I thought the joke was good.
How tall are you?
And I'm 5'9".
I think we're roughly the same. With that hair, you got me probably by an inch or two.
This makes me 6'2" for the joke.
Okay, I don't mind. I don't mind that joke.
Okay, I'll tell you a coronavirus joke now, but you'll have to wait 2 weeks to see if you got it.
Okay. Not bad. How do people react to these? Like, are they offended? Are you? You're not canceled yet after telling these jokes?
Well, I had one. I've only done one kind of offensive one, and I'll tell it to you again if you want to hear it.
Yes, I do.
What goes well with coronavirus?
I don't know. What?
Lyme disease.
All right. So you got canceled for that one?
So far, I'm not canceled.
Oh, okay. Good. Congrats.
I think, you know, the joke is about that coronas and limes go together. That's the whole joke. How is that offensive?
Because I'm offensive. I'm not offensive. I'm sorry. I take that back. I'm offended.
Yeah.
Therefore, you made a mistake. You didn't pay attention. That's how it works these days.
I don't know. You laughed. So I have the recording of you laughing.
I enjoy that. I think it's a good joke.
All right, here's one last joke, and then we'll move on to some fan questions, and then
okay. That's
the show. So,
all right.
Okay, let's have a moment of silence for the people who agreed to live with shitty roommates because they wouldn't be spending much time at home anyway.
I didn't pay enough attention to find it funny.
That's fine. It was too wordy.
Okay.
You like the corona and Lyme disease joke. Let's be real.
That's way more my style. Don't make me think.
Okay, some fan questions from Jackie the Great Zero. Do you have a dream collaboration artist?
I have so many.
Let's just do one.
One?
It doesn't have to be your number one. It can just be one of the few that you have.
Radiohead?
So good. That's such
one of them?
Yeah. Just like with Tom York, or do you want to get like Johnny Greenwood in there and stuff?
I think it would be amazing to just do a song with the whole band, because who knows who's responsible for what part of the magic that they create together.
It's true.
It's always hard to quantify what little bit was more important than another bit. But yeah, Radiohead, would love to make a song with Adele.
Do you have a favorite Radiohead song? Sorry, now I'm just like obsessed with Radiohead.
I don't know if I have a favorite song. I mean, Paranoid Android is always fire. There's so many good songs.
Yeah, it's endless.
Endless.
And I can just, I love that I can just pretty much throw in any record front to back and I'm like very much enjoying the entire thing.
They're good. You don't know Radiohead, not you, but whoever's watching should really give it a shot.
Yeah, I really agree. I would, I put on Kid A the other day and it was a very enjoyable experience. And it still sounds like it's from the future, which is crazy because I think that record came out in 2001, which blew my mind.
That's wild.
It's completely insane. Wow. Okay. JKW Martin says, do you have any advice for amateur producers, people starting out?
Advice for people starting out, I would say you can use inspiration from artists that you like. And as a great exercise, try to get there. You hear something you like, and at least that's how my mind worked. I was always like, how did they do that? And then you just sit down. And for me, it started with Benny Benassi, Satisfaction.
Oh, yeah.
Had like a very, very prominent sidechain. I had no clue how to do sidechain, and it was really complicated in Cubase back then. It's like, I don't even know how to do sidechain. I started with drawing volume automation and just trying different things. And you just try and learn what you hear. Just train your ear. But the most important part comes when you become your own artist, I think, is to find your own lane. As counterintuitive as it sounds, riding the wave of something that's big is much more likely going to fail than trying to find a new path. Because there's a billion other people doing the exact same thing. And even if you're a lot better, you're just drowned out by the noise. So trying to find something new, even being a little bit... like, I had no idea what I was doing in electronic music. I just knew Justice, but I didn't know EDM. I didn't know songs had intros and outros and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I was totally blind and just went for it. And I think I got rewarded for the blind love for what I was doing without really even knowing what I was doing. But I wasn't trying to really follow any specific path. That's probably the number one advice. Learn from the ones that inspire you, but try to find your own lane as early as you can.
But I hope 80% of EDM producers are listening right now, guys. Stop. No, that's good advice. I think trying to emulate stuff to start, I think is like the really good way to start. And I think like finding remix stems is actually a good way to start as well. So you can kind of like see the elements that make up a song. And then that's a great way to learn to emulate as well, because then you can isolate everything.
And another good advice I can actually give, and I don't know how many other artists that really applies to, but at least it applies to me. Try taking any song or an acapella you can find of a popular song and make your own remix of it. Even if it's for example, the remix that you mentioned, the B.O.B. one.
Yeah.
I made that not having any stems. I made that with the MP3 that you get if you buy the song.
Cool.
So just get creative and try doing something, a remix, because for example, when we make recap videos and stuff like that, we always look for new versions and we always just look on YouTube and see who remixed my songs. And then sometimes I like them and I'll just release them and give them a platform. Cool. So I think that's something that's always nice, because people always look for remixes and new versions of the songs that they really like.
Can I just pin your phone number there so people can send you those versions directly?
That would be awesome, yeah.
Okay.
I'll say it on the chat.
Let's see here. Kitty Dilly 87 asked, what was the first instrument that you learned to play?
Piano.
Because I know you played a bunch of instruments, but yeah, so piano was the first one?
Piano was definitely the first one. I started when I was about 4, and then I switched to drums.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of picked up guitar on the way, guitar and bass. I would say that sort of falls in the same category. My guitar skills are definitely not great, but they're good enough to,
play in the strokes.
If you know how to produce music, you can figure it out. Yeah. Like the whole intro of my song Addicted to Memory, which is the first song on True Colors, the whole guitar intro, I literally played string by string. I did one track per string and I just focused on one in it. It sounds cool. It sounds different than if you would humanly play it, but it's cool. Or Smee.
No, I think, yeah, I think, you know, just, and I like that about electronic music is you can approach it in so many different ways. Like, you
totally.
Can't play it, there's like another way to do it.
It's basically Minecraft. You can get and build your castle whichever way you want. You know, there's so many different ways to do it. And music, electronic music to me is just problem solving. You want to do something, it doesn't work. You have to figure out why. Either there's too much of one frequency, or you need a side tune, or you need this, or you need that. And you just build this puzzle from all sides until you put that last piece together and it makes perfect sense.
Do you feel like you know when a song is done, like exactly? Or does it sometimes feel like you just have to like let it go at a certain point?
I usually have a pretty good idea when I'm done with it. I usually get my songs up to 70-80%. Then I find the right vocal. Then I produce the vocal and I put that vocal in, and then I know how much space I need to get for the vocal and where I need to fill space and where I need to take stuff away. And then I listen to it in my car and in my old studio at my house and on my laptop speakers, which is amazing to reference things because you really hear the mid-range and the tone a lot more than you hear on speakers where the sub masks it. And usually I don't overdo it. If a song is amazing, it's amazing. I don't need to keep adding stuff because you have to remember that you will never hear it for the first time again. You will, in fact, never hear it for the first time. So if you have people you trust, ask them how they feel about it. And sometimes people you trust have a better sense of how something feels for the first time than you do because you never heard the song for the first time because you built each element of it on top of each other. So don't overdo it because you get bored of a song because you've been working on it for too long.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a fair point. That, damn, that's like philosophical. You never hear your own song for the first time. That's kind of
it's sad. I wish there was a pill you can take and you forget everything you made for the song and you can actually experience a song for the first time.
There that is.
It's called
a bottle of Jameson as quickly as.
Remember, you asked me about that alcohol.
Someone asked. Farhanda asked, "How did you and I meet?" And I couldn't remember.
What was the name of? You made a song that I really loved, like back in the day before I even really was Zed. And it was, I remember we drove to Sensation White, which is a festival, in Amsterdam, and we burned CDs. Like you could fit 65 minutes on it. And I remember I had one of your songs on it, and it was a jam.
But you don't remember what song.
I think it was. Is there a song that's like a name or like four letters, five letters? 2010, maybe?
Oh, man.
Long time ago.
Like someone, a person's name?
I think so. Or maybe. I think it was just one word.
It wasn't like Joker, was it?
No, I don't think it was Joker. It was amazing. It had a female voice on it.
Okay. I'll have to think because I don't want to just try and like go through my entire discography right now on live. It'll be very embarrassing.
I'll look it up, though.
You can text it with your least favorite song to me after the
put them in one text.
Okay, and the last question for the interview is from Alicia. Do you have any self-coping skills for mental health when you're being alone? I know you're like probably used to being alone.
Yeah,
because of the producer life. Do you think, like, for someone who's maybe not used to that, do you have any advice for that?
Right. Well, I have a couple pieces of advice. First, I think therapy is amazing. I would recommend therapy to anyone who's open to it. Even if you feel good or you think you feel good, somebody professional can always make you feel better or give you the tools that you need to be able to cope with situations that aren't comfortable when that time comes. I think there should never be a stigma about therapy, wanting, needing, recommending therapy. I've really enjoyed therapy, and I went there because, like, if you want to know why, for me, it was a matter of I get really mad when I see certain things on the internet that aren't true about me, and you have nothing you can do about it but let other people, you know, spread lies, and you just have to believe it. And it went even that far. I remember I had my old intro, and I really didn't want to, you know, move away from it because I loved it, and then I decided I'm going to do a new intro. We got all new visuals, and I played it for the first time, and some dude is like, left the Zetro after 5 minutes, he played the same intro. And I was like, that was not only a new first intro and the first new song after that, but it was also new visuals and new light show. He's like, well, you think I'm dumb? I saw it. My buddy saw it too. It was the same intro. So that's when I realized the truth no longer matters. It's just people's perception is the truth, the social truth that people get, right? Is yeah. whatever they think is right. And that really bothered me because I realized that sometimes the truth won't come through because lies will just be bigger. And I wanted, in therapy, I wanted to learn how to let those things not affect me. And what you get is just tools to not get irritated by things that you are out of control of. But obviously yeah. you can do cope with anything.
Do you have a tool that he provided or your therapist provided to deal with that kind of thing?
Well, I think it is probably different for every single case. For me, it was a specific type of case, which probably doesn't apply to a lot of other people. But
yeah, but I think you know, hearing things about you is something that everyone can go through, whether they're at a high school or
that's even, true.
You know,
and I think it takes a lot of practice because even if you know what to do, or for example, sometimes it helps to just like breathe and think about it 5 seconds later. While your initial instinct is anger or something like that, maybe you just wait and think about it and you try to see it from other perspectives and you get a better sense than that anger response that you might come up with first.
Yeah.
Oftentimes being angry at somebody honestly only hurts you more than anything else. Mm-hmm. Sometimes letting things go, even if they are in one particular case, if they're not truthful or whatever, letting them go and just letting them be will make you yourself feel better than trying to constantly go in this loop of that's not fair, that's not fair, that's not right. And everybody has their own issues, right?
Yeah.
But sometimes it's just good to keep going. Like, is the coronavirus fair? Like, some people are hit really hard. I'm not hit as hard as other people because I'm in a lucky position, right? Mm-hmm. But if it hits you hard, you have to keep moving. And it's self-pity and getting into this loop of, you know, feeling angry and all these emotions isn't mm-hmm. going to bring you forward ultimately.
For sure.
So you got to find a way in your situation to make yourself feel better. You can learn that in therapy. You can learn that by listening to podcasts or reading books or
yeah.
meditating, or there's tons of ways. I don't even remember the question you asked actually.
No, you just had help with the mental health during the pandemic.
Yeah.
No, I think that was really great. And I appreciate you sharing the stuff with your therapist because
totally.
That's not easy stuff to talk about. So
yeah,
I appreciate that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I was actually listening to a podcast with Seth Godin. I don't know if you know him.
I don't know.
He's an amazing writer. I'll send you his link afterwards as well. But he kind of just talks about how panicking right now is sort of, it's a decision that you get to make, fortunately. You know, mm-hmm. Obviously everyone is experiencing the same thing, but the level that you decide to panic is ultimately up to you. And it's not, I mean, we have the numbers and the facts and stuff, but how much you react to that is totally dependent on what you
decide. That's true. So that's true.
I think that's really helpful too. It's like, that's why you see the people buying thousands of rolls of toilet paper, which really makes no sense. And it's
never did, never will.
Selfish.
Shows so much about humanity.
Oh yeah.
If shit hits the fan, no pun intended.
You know who's buying thousands? You know, yeah. You know who's buying thousands of toilet roll paper? That guy who said that your intro was the same.
Probably. Exactly. That guy is stocked up. He's got all the toilet paper in the world.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. But I think you're really right, and that applies to many things in life. You know, not everything is fair and not everything is right and not everybody's a good person or has good intentions. And sometimes somebody has good intentions and it actually ends up in a bad situation, but with good intentions. And yeah. I think the way you let it affect you is only in your hand. Certain things come from within and that's stuff you can work on. Everybody can work on.
Yeah, that's good.
That's something I'm working on. Personally,
me too, because I found every time someone's written something horrible to me on the internet and I respond, the minute I do it I'm like, should not have engaged.
You know the amount of times I've responded and deleted the response before I sent it back, because it's like, it's just ultimately most of the times it's just kids who are angry, who
yeah.
don't think you will ever read it and they want attention and they just will do anything in their power, no matter how hurtful, to just get your attention. The best thing to do is genuinely just ignore it and let it go.
Yeah. Respond to the love, not the hate.
That's the move.
There we go. Okay. Well, I think that wraps up the show for today. Thanks so much.
Thank you for having me. It was nice to be on the show. It was nice to talk to you. It's been
a
while.
It's been a while.
It's been a while.
Wait, and I don't video game. So where should I start if I'm going to do it during this quarantine?
I actually was going to mention, that's another thing. Video games are the best way to spend your time with your friends safe, multiple people.
True.
Enjoy something together that you may not do by yourself normally. I play video games every night with my homies on my Discord channel, which, by the way, if I may promote.
You may.
Anybody can join. It's just Discord and just the Zad channel. There's tons of topics people can talk about, and I sometimes jump in and talk to people about whatever. And there's gaming channels, and people can meet up and play whatever game they want to play safely, more than 6 feet apart. And you can have a good time. And I think that is an amazing way, other than watching movies, which you more likely have to do by yourself. Gaming, be talking to other people, be with other people without being physically next to them.
Wait, so which game should I play first, though?
What kind of gamer are you? Do you like first person? Do you like...
So I used to sports? Play like StarCraft way back in the day.
Okay. Well, you can go for StarCraft or Dota or League of Legends. Maybe that's where you start. We got your channels ready to go. 1 and 2.
I'm ready. Do it. All right, dude. Well, thanks for coming on. And
thank you.
Good luck with the music. Good luck with the quarantine. Glad to hear you're doing well. And thank you, everybody in the chat. We have been watching the comments. Sorry we weren't interacting. I know that's kind of counterintuitive to
my bad.
Five, but we appreciate everyone spamming the comment section the whole time. We see the love, and thank you.
Peace.
Peace, bro.
Take care, bud.